dream. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Jesus, he's my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Beloved, yeah, I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing.
Aren't you thankful for that victory we have in Christ? Amen. I like this next verse. It talks about what awaits us.
I heard about that mansion that he has built for me in glory. And I heard about all the streets of gold just beyond the crystal sea. All about the angels singing and that old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there this song of victory. I'll sing of victory. It's in Jesus, he's my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Well, he loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. Oh, victory, send Jesus, my Savior, forever and ever. He saw me and he called me with his redeeming blood. Well, he loved me and I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. Yes, he plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Amen. It's okay. You can clap. It's okay. People sometimes look at you saying, I don't know if it's appropriate, but this is what I feel like we ought to be doing. That's all right. It's okay to enjoy being in the presence of God's people, because we're here to worship the Lord together. There's a song that I think the last time I was here was before there was such a thing as a worldwide pandemic. And I remember the message of this song after when we were in the midst of it. I remember thinking to myself, God, you're still in control. At no point did God relinquish his control to this worldwide pandemic. And for people that are still, maybe you're listening by live stream, if you're still living in fear, I've got good news for you. There's still an omnipotent hand that is in control. Aren't you glad that he's in control of the storms of life? And this old hymn, Brother Tom, if you go ahead and start playing, it says, till the storm passes over, I'm safe within his care.
The storm it passes over, till the thunder it sounds no more, till those clouds they roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. it passes by. In the dark of the midnight, have I oft hid my face, while the storm it howled over me, there was no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Until the storm here passes over, till this thunder it sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the storm.
That we serve a God that is bigger than all of the things that we encounter in life. And if you're here today and you cannot say with 100% certainty that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, may I say before you leave here today that you can march out of those back doors knowing that if something were to happen to you on the road home, you could dwell in the presence of a holy God who loves you. And proved it by sending his son Jesus to die for every sin, so that every sin you've ever committed or ever will commit can be completely and totally forgiven. We serve a great and mighty God. Well, you heard your pastor speak briefly about me, but I want to talk about my wife. I'm glad she was here to be with me. She's not able to travel with me all the time, but man, what a joy it is to have her with me. I was thinking about her. I remember a story about Winston Churchill, the Prime Minister of England. He and his wife were in the park after the World War II. And as they were walking through the park, they noticed off to the side a landscaper. And so she left the Prime Minister's side to go speak to him. And she was gone for an extended period of time, but when she returned, the Prime Minister asked her, "Now, honey, who was that gentleman?" She said, "Honey, that was the man that I dated before you." And so his reply was smugly, "Well, aren't you glad that you married the Prime Minister?" She said, "Honey, if I had married him, he would have been the Prime Minister." You see, I understand that very well, because if you want to know the secret to my ministry outside of the Lord Jesus, it's that young lady right there. So if you haven't met her, be sure to stop by and introduce yourself. Today I'm going to talk with you about life's most important question. And it's one that I think needs to be answered both personally and collectively as a church, because you see, the answer to this question this morning helps define purpose. Are you just kind of going through life, living your 9-to-5 job, going home, watching the same TV programs over and over and over, eating the same food, talking to the same people? But if you were to really analyze what you're doing and why you're doing it, are you really living your life with purpose? There was a young man that was in college, and he was considering that. He was contemplating what the Lord had in store for his life, And so he took a missions trip. And while he was on the missions trip, he had a day off. And so he went shopping out into the marketplace. And he noticed a place that sold exotic birds. And so he was from a small town. His father was a farmer. He said, you know, I really think that my dad would really like to have one of those exotic birds. And so he talked with the store owner, and the store owner said, well, you can't take this bird back with you on the plane, but we'll ship it to wherever you want it to go. So he purchased the bird, gave him the address, and then sent it home to his dad. But he forgot to talk to his dad and explain to him about that bird's arrival, or explain to his father why he had sent it. You know, that question why is very important, isn't it? He figured that out when a few weeks later he called his dad and he said, Dad, did you get my bird? He said, I sure did. He was delicious. He said, Dad, what did you do? He said, well, he arrived and I didn't know what to do, so he looked delicious. I cleaned him. I ate him. He was delicious. He said, Dad, that bird was an exotic bird. He spoke 5 different languages. His dad said, well, then, boy, he ought to have said something. That question, why, is very important. Can we agree on that? Why are you here? Why are you here in church today? You see, for some people, you're here because you're supposed to be here. Maybe you're here because it's the right thing to do, but let me ask you a question. Is that enough? I would say no, and I'll prove it to you, because when the pandemic went away and the excuse for not being in the Lord's house was removed, nearly a third of every congregation across this country had people not returning. A third of their congregation did not return. Why? Because they never knew why they were going in the first place. So I want you to know that there is a purpose and a plan that God has for your life, and you're not going to be able to find that answer anywhere else other than in God's house. See, most people don't know why they go to church, and as a result, they've stopped. Why are you here today? For instance, where are you in life? What goals do you have for yourself and for your family? Most people, when they ask, why has God given you children? What is your desired outcome for your children? What do you foresee for them? Most people would say, well, I want to raise good, moral, upstanding, church-going citizens. Sounds good, but is that enough? You see, we are at a day and time now where society doesn't understand the difference between conservative and Christian. I am conservative because I am Christian, but listen to me, I am not a Christian because I am conservative. And even if you were to accomplish all of those goals, if you were moral, upstanding, and church-going, I want you to know that you could accomplish all of those things and still die without a relationship with Jesus Christ and go to a very real place for all of eternity called hell. We need to know why. Why are we here? Now, listen. Go to that next slide, brother. Even missionaries have struggled with that question of why. Joseph Thom was a famous missionary to Romania. And there was a time in his ministry where he just felt that God had a bigger plan for him than the vision he had. But he couldn't really understand what it was going to take to get that ministry moving forward until he realized it one day in his private Bible study. It's as if God spoke to him through his word and said, Joseph, you have not arrived at the point in your life where you are willing to pay the ultimate price for following Jesus Christ. You are not willing to die for your faith like every member in your congregation. And at that time in Romania, the Communist Party reigned with an ironclad, and they were persecuting everyone that called themselves by the name of Christ. And so he knew the price that he would pay if he became bolder in his faith. But he went and talked to his wife about it and said, "Honey, I really feel God wants me to come to the point where I'm willing to die for this work." She said, "Honey, I've been waiting on you." And the moment that he became more public, the moment that he became more vocal, the persecution started. And on one particular day, they came and raided his office. The chief guard brought a band of soldiers with him, and they rummaged through his library. They had him sign his name to his sermons, to several of the books that were in his library. And just before they left, the head guard pointed a gun in his face and said, "You're about to die." And look at this next quote. Go to the next slide. This was what Joseph Tan said to him that day. He said, "Look, sir, your greatest weapon is your ability to kill. But I want you to know that my greatest weapon is my ability to die. And sir, if you use your weapon, I will be forced to use mine." They left his office and never returned. It was said that one of the soldiers asked the head guard, "Why didn't we just kill him?" And his reply was, "Because if we kill this man, he will become a martyr, and his work will become more powerful than it has ever been during his lifetime." You see, God has given us the ability to live for something and experience something that's greater than the span of our life. How many of us talk often about godly men and women who have gone to the presence of the Lord Jesus, but because of the impact that they made for the cause of Christ, their ministry still is having an impact this side of heaven? Listen, if God can do with their life that, if God can allow them to experience glorious power in their ministry even after they're going to heaven, if God can do it with them, God can do it with you. What's the proof that I have? Here we are 2,000 years from the great commission that God gave to his followers. 11 men took God seriously, and now you and I are here 2,000 years later talking about those same 11 men because their work continues. You may say, "Well, Brother Mike, I long for a day when the power that was once upon our church has returned, and we're seeing people flooding these aisles and people filling these pews." Let me tell you something. The power of God has not changed. We have access to it, friends. But in order to experience it, we need to understand our purpose. We need to answer our why. Go to that next slide, brother. You see, turn in your Bibles to John chapter 10. The Bible has an answer to that question. Why am I here? And we're going to turn to two passages of scripture very quickly. John chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus is speaking of himself. He says, "The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy." But look what Jesus said. He said, "I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." Jesus knew his why. It was number one, so that people would have eternal life. Let me ask you a question here today. Can you say with 100% certainty that you have obtained a transformational relationship with Jesus Christ? Are you 100% sure you're going to heaven? If not, why not? Because the Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, God's word was given us so that we might know that we have eternal life. So if you don't know for sure, you can find out today before you leave. It's the first reason why Jesus Christ came. But it didn't end there. He said, "I'm come that they might have life," but he said that they might also have it more abundantly, meaning so that once a person experiences a transformational relationship with Jesus Christ, they could go on to experience a victorious Christian life. They realized at that point that they were not saved merely to go to heaven. You see, God has a purpose and a plan for your life. You are either disobedient or you are obedient. You have the ability to enter God's word and find out the answer to your why. Why am I here? Go to Luke chapter 19, verse 10. Luke chapter 19, verse 10. Jesus is continuing talking about his purpose. Luke chapter 19, verse 10 says, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." The third reason Jesus knew that that the Father had sent him was so that we could have eternal life, so that we might experience the victorious Christian life, but thirdly, so that we might be able to tell others about him. That's God's purpose for sending Jesus, and that's your purpose for being here today. Why are you here? So that, number one, you can know for sure that you have obtained eternal life. Number two, that you might also be able to experience God's best. But then number three, that you might be able to tell others of what Christ has done for you and what he can do for them. Why am I here? Why are you here? Simply, to number one, that we might really know him. Oh, friend, let me ask you, do you really know him? I'm not asking you if you go to church. I'm not asking if you give or if you serve. I'm not asking if you live a good moral life. All of those things are wonderful. But listen, the reason why I do those things is not because I'm supposed to, but because Jesus Christ, when he saved me, he changed my desires, and I do these things now because I want to. Jesus Christ not only changed what I do, he changed why I do it. Do you really want to be here today? Has God changed you so much within that you truly have a desire to be in God's house, in God's word, with God's people? Or are you simply going through the motions? I want you to know that that's not enough. Going through the motions will not keep you coming, especially when the next problem in life occurs. I want to focus upon the last reason Jesus talked about. How can we effectively make him known? Well, the scripture gives us four things to consider of how we might make him known. The first one is this. We must use his biblical method. Go to that next slide. There you go, brother. This answers the question, what does God want me to do? Boy, that question has been asked from the beginning of time. Ever since God has had a people, they've asked that question, God, what do you want me to do? Maybe you came here. We've got some college kids here. They're asking that question. What's the purpose of my life? Where am I heading? What does God want me to do? I want you to know God's word has the answer. Turn to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. We'll look at verses 18 through 20. Matthew chapter 28, beginning verse 18. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth." Do you know what that shows us? Jesus Christ has the authority to command us and tell us what to do. And if we will yield to it, here's what he tells us to do. He says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world." Now, if you look in that passage of Scripture, you'll see four things that God desires for you. The four things that God desires for you to do. Now, I have preached this message, I think, before on this one passage of Scripture. I spent an entire message on it. But let me remind you of some very important things according to this pastor. He says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations." If you have a margin Bible, that passage can also be rendered, "As you are going, make disciples." Now, how is that possible? Well, first, the first thing that must occur in the life of an individual is salvation. Again, I come back to that. Until you arrive at the point where you can say with 100% certainty that you have experienced a transformational relationship with Jesus Christ, having known him through his death, burial, and resurrection from the dead, putting your faith and trust in him and in him alone, nothing else in life matters. The Bible says, "What is a man profited if he gains the entire world and loses his own soul?" We must start with step number one, which is salvation. But it doesn't end there. Look at that passage of Scripture. He says, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Who are them? Them are the people who received the gospel at the top of verse number 19. These people heard the gospel. They responded. They received Christ as their Savior. And shortly thereafter, they were baptized. Why? Because in the act of baptism, they show by their actions that they're not ashamed to be publicly identified with Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection from the dead. Now listen to me carefully. Baptism doesn't save you. Baptism does not save you. But it is important. It is commanded in Scripture. For what purpose? Why? So that you might, by your public action, show that you are not ashamed to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Baptism just simply tells the people that you're baptized in front of, I am not ashamed of Jesus. Now listen to me. If your baptism came before you got saved, brother, sister, you got wet, but you didn't get scripturally baptized. You see, your baptism has to be on the right side of your salvation, because only those that have experienced God's grace can publicly identify themselves with His death, burial, and resurrection. So, maybe you... the decision that you need to make today is this. Maybe you have already accepted Christ as your Savior, but you have never truly followed the Lord in believer's baptism because you've never been baptized after you got saved. But listen, there's more to it than that. Look at it. I love God's Word, don't you? You see, that baptism in verse number 19 shows that baptism is a connection point. You see, when a person gets baptized, they place themselves in the position of student and the church in the position of teacher so that the church might fulfill verse number 20. Look at verse number 20. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Why are you here? Why has God blessed you with a church? Because here's the reason why God gave you a church. So that the pastor standing here at this desk can open God's Word and instruct you from the Word of God. But listen to me. Every time you open God's Word is like a wonderful meal. But if the only time you're eating, brother, is Sunday morning, you're starving yourself to death spiritually. You have a responsibility for yourself to learn how to study God's Word every day of your life. Why? So that you can get in God's Word, you can receive the instruction from God's Word, that you might know what God would have you to do, and then you have a choice to either obey it or disobey it. But listen to me, the moment that you yield your will to God and you say, God, whatever your Word says, I will do, the moment that you respond to God's Word, you become a little bit less like the old you and a little bit more like Jesus. Amen, Brother Mike. Is that the truth? That's the transformative power of God's Word. Once I'm saved, I get scripturally baptized, and then I become a student of God's Word so that God, through His Word, might transform my life. But now listen, doesn't stop there. Oh, there's so much more. Look at verse number 19. Go back up to verse number 19 and look at the first three words. Go ye therefore. What does that mean? It means to go and do likewise. Now, I'm curious, how many people came to the training session here we had yesterday? Raise your hand very quick. Oh, God bless you. I want you folks to know that the Lord finds great favor with what you did, because what you did was equip yourself to share Jesus with other people. Now, church, listen to me. If you didn't go to that class, it doesn't matter. You still have a responsibility. Why? Because if you have been saved, and if you have been baptized, and you've been here a member of this church and growing in your walk with the Lord, you have a responsibility to tell to others what Jesus Christ has done for you, and what He can do for them. Because you have a responsibility to tell someone else about Jesus just like somebody told you. I remember a young couple that came to our church, and they were on a committee. They were on several committees at another church in our town. And they walked the aisle, and I greeted them at the front. And I said, hello, my name is Mike. Why have you come? He said, we've come to join your church. Wonderful. I shook his hand. I filled out a piece of paper, and pastor read it in front of the congregation. Welcome to the membership of the Florence Baptist Temple, Mike and Kelly. And they were official members of our church. But I said to them, I said, this week I would love to sit down and talk with you about your relationship with Jesus Christ. Because you know why? I understand very well that a person can still be a church member and still be lost. So that week I had a conversation with Mike and Kelly. And I asked him two very important questions. I said, Mike, can you say with 100% certainty you're going to heaven? He said, you had me until you said 100%. Then he asked me the question. He said, can anybody really be 100%? I said, oh, brother, absolutely. I said, can I share some scripture with you? He said, sure. So I opened God's word, and we went through the scripture. And at the end, Mike and Kelly both told me, what you have just described to me, we have never experienced. You see, they had gone to church. They had committed themselves to giving and serving, but they had never committed themselves to the Savior that gave them the power to do it. And right there in my office, Kelly, Mike and Kelly bowed their head and prayed to receive Christ as their Savior. And they started coming to church, and I tell you, I was so excited because within 2 years' time, that same man that I had led to Christ was now my Sunday school teacher at our church. Now, that's a listen, it blessed my heart every time I would be in that, when I was home on a Sunday, and I'd go to Sunday school, that rascal would be up there preaching or teaching the Word of God in Sunday school. Bless my heart. Why? Because Mike, for the first time in his life, knew his why. God has placed me here to instruct others how to become more like Jesus. You see, just like Mike, we are called to follow the Lord's biblical method for helping other people make him coming to know Christ and doing our job of making him known to other people. What does God want us to do? He wants us to follow his biblical method. But number two, we must follow his biblical model. Where this answers the question, where does God want me to do this? Turn, if you would, to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, verse number 8. You're going to see in just a moment that I'm giving you several versions of the same occurrence in Scripture known as the Great Commission. Go back one more screen, brother. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me. Listen to this next word. It's very important. Both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. You see, those locations represented the responsibility that God, Jesus Christ, had given to his 11 apostles. They knew the message they were to share, but now Jesus was giving them the geographical locations for them to share this message. For instance, is there application for you and me? Absolutely, because their Jerusalem represented the people in your life that are lost that you already know. There's a word that we use in our ministry, and I'd like for you to write it down because I think it really helps clarify in the minds of Christians the responsibility that God has given you to share the gospel with the people in your life that are lost. The word is Fran, F-R-A-N. It's an acrostic. F stands for all of your lost friends. All of the friends that you have that are lost. There's only one purpose that God has for you with that friend. I don't care how often you meet with them to play golf or work out or what have you. Whenever y'all are together, God has one thing in mind, and that is for your friend to come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. R represents your lost relatives. All your family members that need to know Jesus, you have a responsibility for them. You need to tell them about Jesus. A stands for your work associates. The people that you spend the most time with outside of your family, I want you to understand you have a responsibility to tell them about Jesus. And then N represents your neighbors. I'm telling you, we live in a different day now. That garage door starts going up before that car is even on the street. And then my neighbor, before the garage door reaches the top, they've already pulled their car into the garage. And before they open the car door, the door's already going down. You say, well, Brother Mike, it's just harder to reach neighbors. It is. But let me tell you something. Is a soul worth the effort? Julie and I, a few years ago, we were burdened about that. And so my wife makes magical banana bread. It has growth properties. Made me the man that I am. And so she and I had the idea that she was going to make several loaves of her banana bread, and we were going to take them around to our neighbors. But attached with that banana bread, an invitation and track. An invitation to our Living Christmas Tree production at our church, and then also a tract telling people how they can have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We went around to all of our neighbors, gave it all out, and then didn't think much about it. You know, we didn't follow up. We just wanted to let people know that we were interested in them, and then give them a little space and maybe follow up later. Well, a few weeks after the Living Christmas Tree production, a card came across my desk. My neighbor had filled out a card during the Living Christmas Tree production with his name and address, and at the bottom, he checked, "I prayed to receive Christ tonight at your program." So I immediately drove to his house, knocked on his door. This man was the head football coach of a local high school in our area. Didn't know that until I introduced myself. He said, "Hey man, come on in." I realized something had already changed in this man's life. He was far more receptive to me the second time. I went into his house and he said, "You know, I went to that program that you invited me to. And oh, by the way, your wife's banana bread was wonderful." I said, "Well, what happened when you came to our program?" He said, "Well, your pastor talked about Jesus and gave the gospel. I want you to know, I prayed to receive Christ that night at your program." And I said, "Brother, I think that's wonderful." He said to me an important question. He said, "What's next?" I said, "Will you allow me to come back and do some Bible study with you?" He said, "Absolutely." And so he began a wonderful journey of faith. But listen, it all took me saying to myself, I have a purpose. Why has God placed these people, these neighbors in my life? It is so that I might make him known. And as a result of my obedience, listen, God blessed us. God blessed us. And now that man is going to spend eternity in heaven. Well, I want you to know that God has given us a responsibility, not only for our Jerusalem, but he said also our Judea. Look back at that verse, Acts 1:8. Judea represents the larger region of people that we do not know. You see, you have a responsibility for people in your life that you do know, but also responsibility for people in your life that you don't know. Well, how do I go about reaching people that I don't know? One word, church. You see, God has placed you in a church so that you might combine your efforts with other church members, so that you might get involved with the ministry of this church to going out into your community and reaching people for Christ. Because you can do more collectively than what you can do alone. That's why in the New Testament you see people going out in two by twos. Why? Because we are stronger together than we are apart. Amen? And for those of you that are watching by live stream, you ought to be here, friend. Because you're stronger here with these people than you are alone. You have a responsibility to tell people about Jesus in your Jerusalem. That's the people that you know. But also in Judea, that's the people that you don't know. But listen, he gave a third region. He said Samaria. Do you know what Samaria represents? People that don't look like you and me. People who may not even speak our language. I want you to know God is going to hold us responsible for everybody that we cross paths with, regardless of their race, regardless of their culture. Everybody deserves the right to hear about Jesus. We've got to tell them about Jesus. We cannot assume that somebody else will talk to someone about the Lord. And listen, in God's house, all people are welcome. So we need to tell people in our Jerusalem, in our Judea, and in our Samaria about Jesus. But he didn't stop there. Look, he says, and the uttermost parts of the earth. You may hear this pastor talking about missions and you say, well, how does that apply to me? You have a responsibility to be a good steward of your resources. Why? So that people can go to the far off distance lands and tell people about Jesus. Why? Because everybody's going to spend eternity somewhere, and we as God's people have got to help in the effort. Amen. That's why we do missions. Because of this thing. These people knew their why. And they also knew where God wanted them to do it. Now, brother, go to that next slide. Let me tell you what I did for our church. I was really intrigued by that geographical area that God had called them to. And so what I did one day was I took a map, a biblical map, that showed those geographical locations as they were in the time when Jesus Christ gave that command. And I took a compass and I drew a circle around that region. And then I took that same geographical location and I lifted it up and I superimposed it upon Florence, South Carolina, where my church is. And I took it to my pastor. And I said, now if Acts chapter 1 verse 8 provides us a template of what God wants us to do and where he would have us to go, I want you to understand, pastor, this is our responsibility. Our responsibility is no great, but no less than what he gave his apostles. And all of a sudden, our eyes were opened because we realized for the first time that we were responsible for people that were within 30 miles of our church. Well, guess what I did for you? I did the same thing for you. So are you ready for this one? Church, here's what you are responsible for. You are responsible that every person in the town of Ladson, in the Ladson area, hear the gospel. Church, you are responsible for every person in Goose Creek hearing the gospel. Anybody ever heard of Hanahan? How about Wildwood, Lincolnville, Woodbridge, Sangaree? Those places sound familiar? Let me tell you, friend, if you are going to follow that biblical model, you have to understand your responsibility, both personally and collectively as a church, to get the gospel out to all of those people. All of them. Why? Because they're going to spend eternity somewhere, and you have a call. You must answer your why. By the way, there are a couple of other places that are in your area of influence that I didn't even call out. Anybody ever heard of the little town of North Charleston? One of the fastest growing cities in the United States of America. And you're sitting right here in the middle of them. Why has God placed your church right here? It is so that they might know about Jesus. So I have but one question for you, and I want to say it with a smile on my face, but let me tell you, friend, you have a job to do, and the question that I have is, are you doing your job? Because if we don't do our job, who will? North Charleston. Anybody ever heard of Somerville? That's within your area of influence. Here's a big one. Ooh. Right over here, Charleston Southern University. God has brought the world to your doorstep, and a question that you have to ask is, what are you doing with this opportunity that God has given you? You see, I want to prod your thinking because this is a model that God gave us. This was not man-made. This was a model that God gave us, and we're either doing our job or we are not. You see, number one, in order to make him known, we must use his biblical method. Number two, we must follow his biblical model. But number three, we must share his biblical message. What am I to tell others? Go to Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. He said unto them, go ye into all the world, and here it is, preach the gospel to every creature. Now don't get hung up on that word preach. Brother Bob will tell you that that word in the Greek, preach, just simply means to teach, to instruct. You are to teach the gospel to every creature. And what is the gospel? The gospel simply means good news. Here's the good news. Everybody look at me. Here's the best news that you can offer to someone who is outside of the grace of God. To hear them, for them to hear you say that Jesus Christ left heaven, was born of a virgin, that he lived a perfect, sinless life, so that he might die a substitutionary death, in order that he might experience a glorious resurrection from the dead, so that every sin they have ever committed or ever will commit can completely and totally be taken away. It can completely be forgiven. Is that a message that the people outside these doors need to hear? That you can be free? I've heard so many stories. Brother Mike, you don't know where I've been. You don't know the things that I've done. My reply is always the same. Brother, you don't know the grace of God. Even in our hymn books, that message rings true. God's grace is greater than our sin. Why did Christ come? So that we might experience a transformational relationship with him, not so that we could live our lives constricted by a man-made religion. It's not about a religion, it's about a relationship, and that relationship will change your life. So I ask you again, why do you go to church? Why do you read your Bible? Why do you live according to the Bible? Is it because you have to, feel like you should, or do you really want to? Has God changed your want to? Are you 100% sure you're going to heaven, and have you experienced a transformational relationship with Jesus Christ? If you've experienced those things, then you should feel compelled to tell others about Jesus. Because the fourth thing is, we must have his biblical motivation. This answers the question, why should I tell others about Jesus? One more passage and then we'll be done. Turn to 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. It reads this. Paul said, "For I am now ready." He's talking to Timothy. "I'm ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing." You see, he had told Timothy, "I'm ready." Paul knew within himself, Paul knew the person that he was before he met Jesus Christ, but he knew the man that had come, that he had become as a result of having experienced this transformational relationship with Jesus Christ. He knew that he was ready. And he also knew that his departure was near. How God had revealed that to him, I don't know. But he knew that his departure was at hand. He said, "I have fought the good fight, and I have finished my course." And when I read that phrase the first time when I began studying for this message, I recall the story of the Olympic athlete in 1992, Derek Redmond. He was competing for Britain in the Olympics, running the 400-meter race. And I remember that race. I watched videos of it on YouTube, where Derek had, if you had asked Derek before the Olympics, "Why are you here? What is your purpose for being here? What is your why?" He would say, "I am here to win Olympic gold." And so when the gun went off and he started his race, he had pulled out in front. And he had gone all the way around, and as he entered the last turn, he tore his Achilles and fell to the ground. Well, when he was on the ground, Derek had a choice to make. He was either going to lay there in his misery. Why? Because his dream of Olympic gold was over. But then a thought occurred to him. "I'm not here for me. I'm here representing king and country." So Derek, in great misery, physical pain, suffering, stood. And I saw him. He began to to run on one leg, limping as he was running around the curb. And just as he was about to fall, just as Derek was about to go down, his father, who was in the stands, leapt out of the stands and ran to Derek's side. He picked up Derek and he said, "Son, I'm here to help you. Let's finish this race together." What is the lesson you and I can learn from this? Because it is a wonderful illustration to this passage of Scripture. The Bible says that 7 times a righteous man falleth, but 7 times he gets up. Why? Because we have a race to run. And just when you're about to fall for that next time, here's what God does. God comes to your aid. God the Father runs to you and says, "Let's finish this race together, because this race called life that you are called to run, I've got good news for you, friend. You do not do it alone. Jesus is there to help us. God is there to help us finish this race. And listen, the one to greet you at the finish line is the one who died to save you. Jesus is there to greet you when you finish this race." And what's so wonderful about this story, I can see with a clear mental picture that day when I see the rewards that are awaiting me extended from the nail-scarred hands of Jesus being offered to me because I finished a race that I was not worthy to even run. But here I am receiving a crown from His extended nail-scarred hands that I will in turn place at His nail-scarred feet in worship. Sadly, there are too many Christians, too many people who call themselves Christ followers that will have nothing to offer at the feet of Jesus. Why? Because they quit the race. We must run this race faithfully.